Hey guys, how you doing? And welcome to my channel. I have a little one who is 6 months old now, and I thought it was about time that I sit down and reflect about my birth story with her. So while I was pregnant, I watched so many birth stories, more so to prepare myself for the labor and the delivery, but also I had no idea what to expect, what I was in for. My thinking behind watching so many birth stories and so many deliveries was that I would kind of know as many outcomes or possibilities as possible that would kind of prepare me for what I may go through. And I know that everyone's birth story is completely different. There's no two that are the same, but for me, it was just getting as much information in as I could to help me process and better prepare myself for my own birth story with my little girl Bella. If I could describe labor in one word, it would be long. It was really, really long. Ooh, two words. Long and exhausting. I think maybe exhausting I would do actually. By the end of it, I was pretty much asleep between pushing. Not like asleep, but just I had no energy. I was completely burnt out. I went over 40 weeks, and at the hospital where we went to, they don't like you to go past 41 weeks. So if you hit that 41 week mark, they will induce you. I didn't really want to have an induction. The method that they do with their induction was a balloon insert to stretch the cervix and everything and hopefully kickstart labor. I did a tiny bit of research, Googling, probably shouldn't have, and wasn't too keen on what I read. So I was like, no. And the entire pregnancy, especially the later stages, I felt like it was going to happen naturally for me. And I wanted to do that, but I actually just felt like my body could do it and was going to do it. I just needed the time to be able to do it, if that makes sense. I kind of break it up for you. I've been getting Braxton-Hicks since about 30 weeks, and I could definitely feel them. I mean, I know people who had them and didn't even know that they had them, but I definitely knew they were there. There was discomfort and sometimes pain for me. I didn't expect that at all. My Braxton-Hicks changed in the sense of they were a lot more painful and a bit more frequent and kind of lowered down. Where the contractions were happening was a different spot, if that makes sense. So we went up to the pregnancy center just to get a checkup. I also had a lot of blood, so I hadn't had any blood the entire pregnancy. So we just wanted to get it checked out. They were so good at the hospital. I had to go to hospital multiple times throughout my pregnancy. I didn't have a great pregnancy. I actually hated being pregnant, but I can do another video on that later if you guys want it. Just let me know in the comments below. We went up to hospital. They have these stretchy bands that they clip a monitor on to your belly so they can monitor Bub's heart rate and check that everything's going okay with Bub, and then do all the checks they need to on Mum. Everything was fine. They did an internal to check if I was early stages of labor or if I was still having Braxton-Hicks, and it came back that I was still having Braxton. I just had the bloody show. It was just a lot more blood than we thought. So all was good. So they sent us home. I pretty much did everything I could to get this kid out. Went for walks. Again, I was really sick throughout my pregnancy, so my walks were like around the block, and that was enough. Then I was pretty much back home and over the toilet again. I had an exercise ball, and it was the best thing. I was on that for, I reckon, 3 or 4 hours throughout the day at least. I would look up YouTube videos on exercises to do while on the ball to help kickstart labor. I found this doula. I think she was American, and I'll try and remember who she is and leave a link down below because she was just amazing. I watched a lot of her videos, and I found the stuff that she put out, especially exercises and that, really, really useful. So I was on the birth ball. I was eating lots of pineapple, like pineapple by the day. That night I was like, all right, we're getting hot curry. We're going to the Indian restaurant down the road, and I'm getting like it hot, and we're gonna just try and flush this kid out. That was sort of the day. In amongst all of that, I had my regular checkup at the hospital. They offered me a stretch and sweep, and I said no. Then they did all the checks and booked me in for an induction window. So I think it was between the Saturday and the Monday. They would find a time for me in there, and I would be contacted to go into the hospital. Then when we left the appointment, I kind of was regretting that I didn't get the stretch and sweep, knowing that then I was gonna be induced. I kind of thought that I'd have another appointment before the induction stage, and I would be able to get a stretch and sweep then. I kind of didn't understand it. Anyway, we went home, had my hot curry for dinner, was on the exercise ball, and I was like, things have definitely changed. The Braxton Hicks contractions that I was getting the night before were different. So I kind of was like, yeah, I'm pretty sure this is the start of labor. Later that night, we went up to the hospital again to the pregnancy center. I didn't take any bags or anything because I was certain that I wasn't going to stay in hospital. And I didn't want to go in hospital that early and be stuck there. I kind of wanted to labor as much as I could at home. But we wanted to just check after the night before that I was actually in labor and that everything was sort of okay with the baby. I hadn't taken anything at this stage. They gave me some Panadine. It kind of took the edge off a little bit. Didn't really do too much, to be honest. And they did an internal and my cervix had actually thinned out quite a lot. So they sent me home and said to wait till they get a bit closer together and then come back up. My mum came and got us. We went home. We really didn't sleep Friday night, no, Thursday night at all. Matt got intervals of sleep and would come and check on me. I was pretty much in the lounge room on the ball, just leaning over the ball. Being on all fours and leaning over the ball was the most comfortable position for me at this point in time. And it just took the weight off my upper body and my lower back especially. I was kind of just rolling around on it until I would sort of get really tired, then I'd lay in bed and then, you know, back and forth. So I labored at home for another 12 hours and then after lunch I was like, things are kind of kicking up a gear. I think they're about 3 minutes apart by that stage. We went up to the hospital. We took our bags this time. It was like the worst time to go to the hospital. When we'd been in the night, it was so calm. There was no one around. It was so nice and chilled. We got in straight away. When we went at lunch, there were so many people trying to get in and have babies or get checkups or, you know, they had problems that they wanted to see somebody about. The waiting room's actually full, so we had to wait in the hallway in the hospital. Every time I would get a contraction, I would sort of bend down on the floor and grab onto Matt, just breathe through it. And then I was just pacing up and down the corridor in between my contractions. But all I was thinking was get me out of here. I just want to be in a room. My contractions sort of intensified while we were there. A couple of times Matt had to go to the desk and be like, look, can we get in? Can, like, they're kind of getting quicker. And I couldn't go straight into a birth suite because they needed to obviously check that they were actually 3 minutes or so 2.5 minutes apart. So we eventually got in the room. I lay down on the bed. They put the monitor on the bub again and did all the checks on me. And as soon as I lay down, my contractions stopped. They were just non-existent. And the nurse came in and was like, I don't know why you guys are kind of here. Not here, but just kind of like, you know, this is way too early. You need to be 3 minutes apart. And I'm like, I have been 3 minutes apart. We've been timing. You know, we had the little timer app. I was like, look, this is what's been going on. And she was just like, but it's not happening now. Like, I need to see it now. And then she even said to us, you need to be active. You need to be walking around between your contractions. The bed did not help. Because we'd been in the night before, they actually didn't want us to go home. We got sent up to one of the wards. It was actually really good. We had our own private room with ensuite. Matt had a bed and I just sort of labored in there. They actually had a birth ball in the room. They had a chair in the shower, which I could use, and they just sort of let us do our thing. And then if we needed, we could just call the nurse and get her to come in and do a checkup. I used the birth ball again. I was pretty much on that most of the time. And I went into the shower and just sat with the hot water on. So I'd alternate between having the hose on my lower tummy and on my lower back. And it was just so nice. And I think I was in there for about 45 minutes. But it was just so relaxing to just have that and have that time in my labor where it was just me breathing through the contractions on my own. No one else was in the room. I shut the door so Matt was outside. And it was actually kind of a really nice time to just, I don't know, just think this is it. I didn't know how long at that point, but I'm going to meet my kid. While we're in the ward, the nurses just said, look, you need to be active. You cannot really rest. Resting is what kind of slows down labor. Matt was like, we have to walk. You just have to get up and do it. And honestly, it was the last thing I wanted to do. I was so frustrated, but I also was so tired that I couldn't be frustrated. And I think that was the thing. Like, I was so tired, I just wanted to lay down. But laying down, I was so uncomfortable that I wanted to stand up, if that makes sense. So I sort of was shuffling around. I was holding onto his forearms and we were just shuffling around the ward. And then when I'd get a contraction, I would just, you know, grit my teeth and swear a bit. There were all new mums with their babies in this ward too. It wasn't like it was a ward for people that were in labor. We just shuffled around for I don't even know how many hours, and then we'd come back and have a rest. And the nurses came in and gave me some temazepam and Panadine Fort just to try to get me to sleep because I hadn't slept. I didn't have the mental capacity to tell them that Panadine Fort makes me really drowsy. It doesn't actually really do anything for pain for me. It just makes me real groggy. Anyway, they gave it to me and I was just, I definitely paid for it when I was trying to push. But I managed to get like half an hour sleep, and then I just had this I can't even explain it, but I still remember the feeling. This massive, intense contraction all around my stomach, and I honestly just felt like, I've never been tasered, but maybe like what a tasering would feel like across the midsection of your body. I just remember screaming and sort of like leaped out of bed as a pregnant woman would. And Matt woke up and was like, what happened? And I fell to the ground, and then he sort of lifted me up, and I just had this gush of fluid come out. My waters broke. That's one thing that in all my research I didn't really read too much in or hear a lot about, is people's waters breaking. So mine happened naturally. I was wearing baggy trackies and they were covered. They were just destroyed, and they were going to be my hospital pants. And the fluid just sort of kept coming for the next at least half hour to an hour. I had to change my undies. They had their sheet protector things that they put on the pillow when you go to a doctor's visit. They have one of them, two pads on top just to hold some of the fluid. Everything intensified after that point. I was on all fours, just writhing in pain and just screaming. Looking back, I'm like, oh my god, the poor people on that ward that had newborn babies. Obviously the doors are shut. I think it's relatively sound. I was not quiet at all. The nurse came in and was like, all right, you're good to go down to the birth suite. So they got a wheelchair, wheeled me down to the birth suite. We'd done a tour of the birth suite, so I knew what to expect, which was really nice. Bub was posterior, so that means that Bub's back was on my back and the head was facing outwards. Ideally, they prefer Bub to be anterior, so facing towards your back, and their back laying against your stomach. While everything was being set up down in the birth suite, because Bub was posterior, all I felt like doing was going to the toilet. I honestly just thought, I need to poo. I couldn't even explain it. It was like there was just all this stuff built up ready to come out, and it was like I didn't need to poo. I just had that feeling of needing to poo, but it was the baby. So I was sitting on the toilet. Just that position was so comfortable. So I'd go between sort of that position, sitting on the toilet, and going down on all fours on the floor. My contractions had really intensified, so I asked for gas. Gas makes a lot of my family quite sick. I didn't know how I was going to react to it, but it made me so groggy. I just felt really nauseous from it, and you're only meant to breathe it in during a contraction. I was doing that for the most part, but then I was also being like breathing in when I wasn't contracting, because I just needed something to do to sort of take my mind off it. The nurse on the ward and the midwives in the birth suite both recommended that I get an epidural. So I think by this stage I was 27 hours into it, and they were just like, look, you've not really slept. I think an epidural would be good because we don't know how much longer you've got to go, and it'll help conserve your energy so that you've got as much energy as possible for the delivery stage and the pushing. Matt just looked at me and said, look, if you're keen, I think it's a good idea. So I was like, yeah, if you guys can get it set up, that would be good. Epidural takes about an hour for the procedure, so it's 20 minutes to set up, 20 minutes to do the actual procedure, and then 20 minutes to tell if it's worked. So when I got the epidural, everything numbed, so they do the ice test on you. So they'll drag ice up your leg and then up the side of you. You've got to let them know when you can feel the ice. Mine was just under my boobs. The midwife tried to turn Bub's head to try to get Bub to face anterior instead of posterior. So I would alternate between laying on my left side, laying on my right side. The midwife and Matt would have to rotate me because obviously I couldn't move. And they'd put like a big birth ball that was sort of shaped like a Kong in between my legs just to try to get Bub to move. Didn't work. Baby was stubborn, and that's just how it was. Once I got the epidural, I had shakes until after Bub came out. I think I had 3 blankets on me because I was just shaking so much. And it is apparently a side effect that you can get when you have the epidural, but for me it was really intense. My whole body would just shake, and I was vomiting. So I was vomiting even when I had the gas. I don't know if it was from the gas, it could have been, but I was just, you know, vomit bag was right there. I hadn't read or watched this anywhere, but once I got the epidural, I just felt this constricted discomfort. It wasn't painful at all, but this unsettling restrictiveness around my chest, and it was because I was having a contraction and everything was tightening. It was kind of good to have that though, because then I knew when to push in delivery. And then at 5 a.m. the midwife checked, and I had gone to 10 centimeters, which was awesome. They left me for a little bit to get everything set up, and then we started pushings because I'd had the epidural. It was kind of like what you see in the movies. You have both your legs. I can't even do it. I don't have the strength. Both your legs up, holding them. So one midwife was on one side, Matt was on the other, holding my legs up and back. And then I would have to grab under them and bring my body forward, bear down, and push. We were pushing for a while. Not as long as some people. Granted, after an hour, nothing was really happening. The head had definitely come down, so she got Matt to have a look. She could see Bub's hair, and she got me to have a feel so I could feel Bub's head. It was really close. So we tried again, and then not long after, there was a shift swap. So we'd had this midwife our entire entire time in the birth suite. It was kind of bittersweet. She'd been there this whole time and wasn't going to sort of be there for the birth. But another midwife came in and she had a trainee with her. I was kind of annoyed at the time that there was a shift swap while I was pushing, but it actually was a blessing in disguise because the midwife that we had initially, she was much older. She was in her 60s. She was really nurturing, really calm, really caring. And I think that's what I needed while I was in the labor stage. Once I'd sort of got the epidural and was a little bit scared and everything, she was sort of there to really comfort me. And then the next midwife that came in was a real firecracker. She was probably in her 40s. I'm sure she was a PT in another life. She was, all right, girl, we're gonna go. We're gonna get it. This is it. This is your moment. We're gonna push. She was on one side, Matt was on the other. And then I had the practice student was, I think, I don't even know. She may have been like at the bottom, like not my bum, like the bottom of the bed. And so I was pushing. They were like, come on, let's go. Let's get it out. A couple more pushes. And I was like, you're trying to push. And something just wasn't happening. By this stage, it was 36 hours or something. So I was exhausted. I'd had max 2 hours sleep. I was just rooted between contractions. I was just, my eyes were shut and I was just laying back, not really coherent or responding to people. Still the lights were all off. I was still pushing. It was all good. Not off, the lights were dim. And then all of a sudden, someone must have hit a button or something, but the lights just flicked on. There was 10 people in the room. It all happened so quickly and so suddenly. I don't even know. Unbeknownst to me, the doctor that delivered Bub pulled Matt aside and explained to him what was going on and what their plan of attack was. So everyone still reassured me. I thought everything was all good. I was still really calm. I actually thought that everyone was in the room because I was so tired and needed help to get the baby out. Like, because I was so tired, it wasn't actually because something was wrong. I'd been pushing for about an hour and 15, maybe a little bit more, but Bub's heart rate was dropping. It can drop a little bit, but then it recovers. So Bub's heart rate was just not recovering. It was sitting at around 50 beats per minute. So they were like, all right, we need to get this kid out. The doctor sat down at the end of me and was like, all right, let's give it a go. I want to see what you've got. Let's try and get this baby out. So I tried to push and they were like, all right, we're just going to help you along here. They did an episiotomy, so that's where they cut you. So I didn't tear or anything, just to help the area stretch and give Bub a bit more room to get out. And then the doctor put a suction cup on Bub's head. And within 3 pushes, baby was out. As Bub was coming out, one of the midwives told me to look down. And I was sort of like, I don't want to look, like, I don't want to see it. But it was really cool. I got to see them pull the baby out. They put Bub on my chest and we didn't know what we were having. Matt opened the legs and was like, it's a girl. And so we had a little baby girl. You just get this adrenaline rush. I think it's the oxytocin that goes through your body. I was just so wired. I was so alert. I was so awake. And Bub was so alert. It was just the best moment, I think, for both myself and Matt. That was my birth story with my little girl, Bella. So if you like this video, please give it a thumbs up as it really supports my channel. And don't forget to hit the subscribe button. I'll be posting videos every week of my organized chaos motherhood journey that I am currently going through with my little girl. So stay tuned for the next one. Anyway, see you guys.